Come, Holy Spirit, come now, come as you wish. Come, Holy Spirit, come now, come as you wish. Come, Holy Spirit, come now, come as you wish. Looking at the Bible studies which we have here, and this is what I'm trying to teach on Sundays, on weekends, I think you understand that you cannot get all the things from the New Testament unless you connect it to the Old Testament, to the Hebrew Scripture. And this title for today, to see what Jesus has done, is in the view of the prophet Elisha, who fed people in Old Testament, and there's a new Elisha, a greater than the Old Testament prophet, feeds 5,000 people. The story of the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000 is the most well-known of the public ministry of Jesus, because it's the only miracle of Jesus that's recorded in all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They usually have something, but not all of them. And it's something like you look at the same event from the different cameras. Only Matthew is saying about women and children. Only John is writing about the boy who had these five little breads and two fishes, and there was barely bread. Only John writes it. So if you look from different angles, you have even more supporting evidence. This feeding is a kind of visible and external sign of Jesus' visible divine power. It shows us that Jesus isn't just a good preacher or a great rabbi, he also has power over creation and is immediately projected to God, because only God has power over the creation. Actually, it's not just 5,000 men. Matthew tells us, not including women and children. So you can imagine a crowd of thousands of people, and it's clearly a miracle of multiplication. Other Gospels, it was the third day, so they were quite exhausted and maybe quite hungry, out of resources. There are striking parallels between what Jesus asked his disciples to do in this feeding and a famous miracle from the Old Testament, a miracle of multiplication that is tied to the prophet Elisha. Elisha is the successor of the great prophet Elijah, and he was a very powerful prophet. There are only a few prominent miracle workers in the Old Testament. If you compare New Testament and Old, there's plenty of miracles, plenty of extraordinary things happening also after the death of Jesus. And in the Old Testament, only few of them really had this privilege. Moses had the miracles associated with the Exodus when they're going out of Egypt. Elijah and Elisha are the other great prophets and miracle workers in the Old Testament, and not really much more. One of them involves multiplying loaves of bread so that a large number of people can eat them. It's the passage in the second book of Kings. A man came bringing to man of God, that's Elisha, bread of the first fruits, 20 loaves of barley. His servant said, "How am I to set this before 100 men?" This was barely bread. It's a tiny bread. It was like one bread for one person. And when the prophet said, "Do it, you know, feed the people," how do you want to feed them? And Elisha prayed, and the result was obvious. And they ate and had some left according to the word of the Lord. So Elisha takes those 20 loaves and multiplies them for 100 men. It's obviously some kind of miracle. And Jesus takes the 5 loaves and multiplies them to 5,000 men, not counting women and children, so thousands of people. In both cases, we have some left over as a sign that it was a generous blessing from God. Elisha has some buts, but it's not specified exactly how much is left over. Jesus in the Gospel makes very clear that there are 12 baskets leftovers from the fragments of the 5 loaves. People very often are asking, where did they find these 12 baskets? If you make the wrong question, you make all the wrong answers. The question should be, why 12? 12 tribes of Israel? 5 loaves, Israel, Torah. So the miracle was definitely done on the Jewish side of Jordan. And the miracle was for the Jewish people. So it's very important to ask right questions. What do these parallels reveal to us? Jesus in the Gospel of Matthew is not just the son of David, the long-awaited Messiah. He's not just the son of Abraham, the one who is going to fulfill the promise of blessings of the nations. And Jesus is a new and greater Elisha. Elisha multiplied 20 loaves and fed 100 men. Jesus multiplied fewer loaves, 5 loaves, and fed thousands of people. So you can immediately see much greater sign. In the Gospel of Matthew, there is the image of Jesus as the greater than. Jesus said this, something greater than the temple is here. So Jesus is the new temple, the dwelling place of God on earth. He's God. So he's greater than the earthly temple of Solomon. Jesus also said, something greater than Solomon is here. And Jesus is a wise king, just like Solomon, but he's a new and greater Solomon. So you can apply it in this typology to any of the figures of the Old Testament. Jesus didn't say it, but we could say, something greater than Elisha is here. Just look at the number of the loaves. It's somehow very much obvious. So in a Jewish context, this miracle would have been an extraordinary display of Jesus' exceptional, unprecedented power over creation. Only God has such power. None of the human beings can do it. So what about the Old Testament reading of today, the first reading? It has a call from God to the people of Israel to come to his banquet of food and drink, which is free. That's the good news. Come, everyone who has no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. You know that food costs. The more members of the family, the more money you have to spend. And I bet many people would stop working if they wouldn't need money for daily food. Just as in ancient times, so today, you offer people free food and drink, and they will come. It works even in Holy Spirit. And that it works all over the world the same way. He also makes clear that this isn't an earthly food and drink. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Remember, Isaiah was 700 years before Jesus was ever born. If you talk about the fulfillment of the prophecies, as soon as we eat and drink, it's not going to be very long before we are hungry and thirsty again. So incline your ear and come to me, come to God. Hear that your soul may live. So already that time they understood that the life of the soul is much more important than the life of the body. The food and drink that Isaiah described is a spiritual one. They didn't know how it would be supplied, but the inspiration was true. In the last line of today's first reading, God says, I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. And you can wonder, why in the midst of this banquet does God bring up David and the covenant? And there were several covenants before the Christian covenant. When God enters into the covenant with Israel, he enters into a sacred relationship with them. Remember Noah, Abraham, Moses, the very much known covenants, and they became kind of family of God. He becomes the bridegroom, and they are the bride. It's a spiritual marriage between Israel and the Lord, between the God and his creature. And you know what is the difference between the brother, sister, and a friend? Friend you can choose. Family member you cannot choose. They just are. Just see how God is stuck with us. So one of the key signs of that covenant in the Old Testament is the bread of presence. This is the Old Testament expression, bread of presence. It came later to be known as the description of the Eucharist, but it's there. The bread of presence was a sacrifice which was set out every week, usually on Sabbath day, by the priest. It would be offered with a flagon of wine, so it consisted of bread and wine offered to God for centuries before Jesus was ever born. It was a sacrifice, but it was not bloody sacrifice. And the description, explanation have in Leviticus in 24. Aaron shall set it in order before the Lord continually on behalf of the people of Israel as a covenant forever. One of the privileges of us, that God never regrets his choices. God never takes away his promises. He can suspend temporarily some kind of rewards, but he keeps his word. It was a bread and wine sacrifice centuries before it came as the presence of the living God in the Eucharist. A buried olam is in Hebrew for an eternal covenant. And Isaiah is describing this feast of bread and wine that will satisfy as being tied to the everlasting covenant. The bread and wine of the presence was placed in the tabernacle in the Holy of Holies in the Jerusalem temple, just that you tied it. It's fascinating that in this prophecy there is a direct echo of the bread and wine as the presence of God. Just refer to this, what is happening on the altar. This messianic banquet was something that many Jews were waiting for. They were hoping for the final inauguration of the age of the Messiah. This is what they were waiting for. The idea of the messianic banquet comes from Isaiah chapter 25, 700 years before. God speaks there about a banquet of fine wine that he is going to give for all people. And he's going to swallow up death forever and take away his people's sins. Sounds familiar? 700 years before it happened? The feeding of the 5,000 points back to the prophecies of the Old Testament, to the miracle of Elisha. It points back to the banquet that Isaiah talks about where God will feed the multitudes. And these Old Testament prophecies point also forward to the Last Supper. Remember that the Gospels were written after everything happened. So it was new eyes, new perception. That time when Jesus multiplied this bread and fish, nobody could connect it to the Eucharist or Last Supper because the Last Supper did not yet happen. So nobody, including apostles, understood anything of it, because it was a kind of prophecy which will be fulfilled in near future. So because at the Last Supper, Jesus is going to identify his own presence with his body and with his blood, and then the understanding comes. He will give the new bread of the presence and the new wine of the new covenant. Jesus will give food and drink which will actually satisfy, but not on a material level. It satisfies from inside, from the internal life. So Jesus will feed the souls of his disciples. If we have to live forever and we got this seed on our baptism day, it needs food. Like the seeds, needs water, fertilizer, soil. And Jesus is providing this food. We'll be never short of it. In this way, Jesus is fulfilling the prophecy of Isaiah of the messianic banquet. I like this example from Frances Hogan. She attended some mass in Dublin in Ireland, and it was crowded church. People was not only sitting but also standing between pews. There was a crowd of people for Holy Communion, and there was one young lady, and she was making her way with elbows, pushing the people aside, and this old lady, she grasped her and said, "Oh, hold your horses. There will be enough for you and for me. There will be enough for your children and your children's children, as long as we act in obedience to Jesus." So there is also rationalistic interpretation that denies the miraculous element. It's good that you know it and that you know how to answer. This was promoted by a German scholar, Paulus, in the 19th century. So this deviation came very short from us after 19 centuries of Christianity. Paulus was a rationalist and he didn't believe that miracles were possible. I don't know how can you be Christians and not believing in the miracles. How can you go around of resurrection of Lazarus and many other things? But the problem is, you might be surprised when I'm repeating it again, because it's an answer to many questions. Jesus is a divine person. First of all, he's divine, then he's human. I give you another words. I was really impressed by this way of talking. Rosalind Moss, a Jewish convert to the Catholic Church, and she was struggling, you know, how human can become God? It's impossible that human becomes God. And it's true. Wrong question, wrong answer. The question is, can God become human? And if you get the right question, you have all the right answers. If Jesus is only human, the miracle is impossible. But if Jesus is divine, who assumed the human nature and time, everything makes perfect sense. Paul came up with an interpretation that all what actually happened was a miracle of sharing. Jesus gave good example of sharing his food, you know, and everybody was following his example. If you read all these four accounts, then you know that Jesus didn't have any even single bread. The bread was given to him by this little boy. So he didn't have anything to share. It is easy to show why that is a false exegesis. It's a perfect example of what scholars call Isa Jesus. You don't have to remember this term, but you have to know that something like this exists. It is not drawing out the meaning from the text, but reading something into the text that is not in the text. Benedict XVI, he wrote this Jesus of Nazareth, beautiful books, and he referred to one of this scholarly elaborated paragraph, and he finished, it's a beautiful story. But there is no evidence in the Bible about the story. It's your invention. It's your fantasy. There must be evidence in the text. And even worse, it is at odds with what the passages actually says. Jesus didn't have anything to share. And even more, if you compare all the accounts in the Gospels, it is really clear that the fragments of the 12 baskets are filled from the broken pieces. They are from the 5 loaves that Jesus himself takes, breaks, blesses, and gives to the apostles. He is the source of the miracle. It's not the apostles. He blessed, he did his part, and then giving to the apostles, it's his offer of the Eucharist. It's giving to minister and distributing to the people. It's exactly the same mechanism. There is no way for 5 loaves of bread to feed 5,000 people unless there was some kind of miracle of multiplication took place. There's no way to fill up 12 wheat baskets, you know, with leftovers from 5 breads. So this Isa Jesus is really a very false exegesis. So if this is not in the text, it's your interpretation, it's your fantasy, but not really message from the Bible. So the reason Jesus allows there to be this surplus, this 12 basket leftovers, is that everyone would realize that what happened with multiplication was not an illusion. You can go and touch. Remember after the resurrection, when he took the fish and left it on the table? Mercifully, they don't write what happened afterwards, how everybody was touching the fish and checking if he really ate the fish which was just on the table. Of course, Jesus sets an example for generosity, for charity, for sharing in the miracle of the multiplication of the loaves, in this feeding of the 5,000. But it's wrong focus. It's a miracle of divine generosity. God has more that we can ever ask for than we can even imagine. So to conclude, in the feeding of the 5,000, Jesus reveals his identity as the Messiah. He points to the Last Supper, where he will give the food that will feed the souls of humanity, which will supply our need for eternal life. Jesus also teaches us about the superabundant generosity of God. He can supply, he can provide. Just put trust in him. The one who made the universe indeed gives us our food in due season. He opens wide his hand to us and to all creation. Just to give you some example, my sister, who was a widow at the age of 36, left with 3 children, her husband died on tumor, just fell down and 2 days later died. Years later, she was complaining that she had never savings. She was just like bumper to bumper, you know, and there was everything with her. I was poor missionary from Africa at that time. So I make her a question. Have you ever wondered that you are not short? And being a widow, being a teacher, not having plenty of money, that there was money for children, there was even money for vocation, that there was always someone helping, taking boys or girls, you know, somewhere else to have some extended family, that you are never short. There's plenty to give thanks to God. In the Eucharist above all, Jesus gives us the food that nourishes and satisfies for eternal life. And for this, we should be also thankful.